le monde. J'espère que vous avez un bon sommeil et que vous êtes prêts pour un autre jour de conférence au sujet des sciences et de la théologie. Good morning, everybody. I hope that you all had a very good night's sleep and that you're ready for another day of lectures on Sabbatical Science and Theology. This morning, we have the privilege to listen to Dr. Lydia Charrière, who holds a permanent lectureship in the Academical Dean and is the Academical Dean at Nogent Bible Institute in Nogent-sur-Marne, an interdenominational evangelical Bible college situated near Paris. She obtained her PhD in philosophy at the University of Sorbonne on the possible links between the concept of laws and nature and religious presuppositions. Since 2000, Dr. Charrière has had several short leaves in order to study at the Department of History and Philosophy of Science at the University of Cambridge, Great Britain, where she's also an associate member of the St. Edmund's College and of the Faraday Institute for Sciences and Religion. From 2005 to 2010, she held a research professorship in philosophy of science and contemporary thought, joint based at the Evangelical Theological Seminary in Vaux-sur-Seine and the Institut Biblique de Nogent-sur-Marne. Since 2012, she has been coordinating a joint project with the Groupe Biblique Universitaire to develop evangelical science-based resources for the Francophone world. Her current research interests are natural order, the epistemology and ethical implications of the doctrine of creation, the theology of science, and our understanding of humankind in the light of evolutionary biology, neuroscience, and philosophy. She has, of course, published quite a lot, but I will just name some books. The first, Models of the Fall, including the historical Adam and ancestor of all humans, Science and Theological Constraints. Another one is titled Science and Christian Belief. The third one, Facts and Theories in Science and Theology, Implications for the Nobles of Human Origin. And then we have another one, Change in a Creative World, How to Avoid Common Misunderstandings About Divine Activity. Her lectures today concerns physics and theology and is titled The Twin Truths of Divine Immanence and Transcendence, Creation, Laws of Nature, and Personal Agency. Now I welcome Dr. Charrière.
So thank you for the introduction and thank you for the invitation to the ESAT Council. Divine transcendence, immanence. At first glance, divine transcendence and immanence seem to be conflicting truths, stressing the distinction between God and the world. The radical otherness of the divine may make it harder to allow for God's active and caring involvement in the world. But if we emphasize instead God's intimate presence in nature, his pervading of all that exists, then the pantheistic confusion of the deity and the world lurks round the corner. Notwithstanding, the best of Christian tradition has always firmly held together both truths. It is sufficient for our purposes to mention just two representatives of the joint confession of divine immanence and transcendence in the great Christian tradition. So first, Augustine. In fact, divine transcendence and immanence are in the very first pages, in the opening paragraphs of his confessions. But I don't want to go into a thorough study of the confessions. Just take one quote from Augustine. You were deeper within me than the most secret part of me and greater than the best of me. Or if you prefer the original Latin, tu eras interior intimo meo et superior sumo meo. It's difficult to affirm more strongly together divine transcendence and immanence. Just take Another witness from the great Christian tradition, Thomas Aquinas. When Aquinas asks in his Summa Theologica the question whether God is in all things, his answer is unambiguous. As long as a thing has being, God must be present to it, according to its mode of being. But being is innermost in each thing. Hence it must be that God is in all things and innermostly. It is creation which leads him to hold together divine transcendence and immanence. I once again quote, God is above all things by the excellence of his nature. Nevertheless, he is in all things as the cause of the being of all things. It should not come as a surprise that the great Christian tradition has firmly held to both divine transcendence and immanence. In fact, Augustine, Aquinas, and many more learned from Scripture that these two truths are not in tension with each other, but that they can be understood within the common framework of creation. A locus classicus is Paul's speech to the Areopagus in Acts 17. Creation occupies center stage when the apostle confronts his Greek audience with the biblical God. I quote, "What you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and everything in it." And then from creation, the apostle deduces different aspects of God's transcendence: his sovereign lordship, his Lord of heaven and earth, the impossibility to limit his presence to specific places. He does not live in temples made by man. And his aseity. He is not served by human hands as though he needed anything. This transcendent creator God is at the same time, and in virtue of being the creator, the God who is near. He is not far from each one of us, says Paul. Paul perhaps quotes a verse known to his public without fearing the pantheistic overtones which such a statement may well have had in the ears of those who listened to him. In him we live and move and have our being. Stressing divine immanence is not a concession to his pagan audience in Athens. Divine transcendence and immanence are also intertwined in Paul's teaching in his letters. The most concise statement is to be found in Ephesians 4, verse 6, "One God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." And the same twin truths can be predicated of the Son. In Colossians 1, "All things were created through him," the Son, "and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together." Confessing divine transcendence and immanence articulated through creation is not a theological invention of the apostle to the Gentiles. With his teaching, Paul sits squarely within the tradition of the Hebrew Bible. The most beautiful poetic expression of divine immanence is certainly to be found in Psalm 139. "Where shall I go from your spirit, or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me." God's immanence, his being present everywhere and actively involved with everything and everyone, is but the corollary of his transcending the world. God is omniscient. The psalmist prays, "O Lord, you discern my thoughts from afar. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether." God is beyond human understanding. Nobody can escape his rule. He foresees all the future life of the psalmist. "In your book were written every one of my days." And once again, creation is not very far from the biblical author's mind. It is as a creature that he is totally open to God's presence. You formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are all your works. It is a remarkable feature of the biblical teaching on divine transcendence and immanence that there is no hint of any tension between those affirmations. No felt need to tinker with transcendence in order to allow for a robust notion of immanence, or to water down immanence in order to get a stronger concept of transcendence. These biblical treatments of divine transcendence and immanence show that it would be wrong to pit one against the other. Rather, they support one another. It is as the transcendent creator, absolutely distinct from, sovereign over, and non-dependent on his creation, that God is upholding the universe, intimately and actively involved in its history, and in particularly in human life. The idea that God would have to withdraw, to limit himself, in order to allow creation to be, would be utterly foreign to the biblical authors. I doubt that they would understand why Jürgen Moltmann resorts to the Kabbalistic concept of Zimzum in order to account for creation. So Zimzum, for Hebrew, concentration, contraction, that God has to withdraw in order to allow creation to be. Moltmann strives, as he writes, to set forth a thoroughly Trinitarian doctrine of creation. He considers that too much of traditional thinking started, and I quote, from an antithesis between God and the world. God is not worldly and the world is not divine. But such a dualistic outlook cannot properly account for divine immanence. Instead, the so-called Trinitarian doctrine of creation, and once again I quote, proceeds differently, starting from an immanent tension in God himself. God creates the world and at the same time enters into it. He calls it into existence and at the same time manifests himself through its being. But does Moltmann really overcome dualism between God and the world? Why consider that God has first to retreat, to make room in order for the world to really be? It most certainly is not a slip of the tongue when Moltmann speaks of a tension in God. No such tension can be perceived in any of the biblical treatments of divine transcendence and immanence. Instead of speculating on how creation is possible, on how God can be at the same time the transcendent sovereign Lord of all and intimately immanent in the world, the biblical authors, from the very first sentence onwards, reflect on the relationship between God and the world in the context of creation. Creation is a given. It's a fundamental metaphysical category which does not need any explanation, but which sheds light on all of natural and human existence. I quote from Henri Blocher, "Instead of the natural world, theology finds its starting point in God, the Semper Agens. It tells of his acts before asking about being. This insight may free us from the dilemma of monism, that is, everything is in God, and dualism, that is, God is distinct from the world, dialectically opposed or related. The starting point taught by Scripture is the creator-creature pattern. We cannot raise ourselves higher and dominate the constitutive structure. We cannot subsume it under an all-embracing notion of being. It involves a real duality, non-symmetrical, absolute independence on one side, total dependence on the other. The obedience of faith in receiving this orientation as the principle of sound thinking does not boast that it has solved the monistic, dualistic antinomy, but humbly refuses it." Or to use Wittgensteinian language, instead of solving the puzzle of how God can be both transcendent and immanent, creation dissolves it and leads us to affirm both truths as strongly as we possibly can. Concerning transcendence, God is truly the eternal, omniscient, and omnipotent creator, wholly distant from the world and sovereign Lord over all. Concerning immanence, there is no need for any form of divine self-limitation whatsoever. In him truly we live and move and have our being. But is it not arbitrary to simply affirm that divine transcendence and immanence go together on the basis of creation? Is it not a fideistic maneuver to just take creation for granted? I would like to argue that this is not the case, that Christians are warranted in taking creation as the starting point of their understanding of the God-world relationship, which then dissolves the perceived antinomy between God's transcendence and immanence. Firstly, we have learned from the failure of strong foundationalism that there are no evident, infallible, or incorrigible truths from which human reflection could start. All philosophical systems use unproven axioms. Neo-Calvinists such as Abraham Kuyper, Hermann Doyeweerd, or Cornelius van Til had argued that faith precedes knowledge long before the failure of foundationalism became received wisdom and in epistemology. But the turning point came through Thomas Kuhn's The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. Building on the ideas of Michael Polanyi, Thomas Kuhn showed by detailed historical studies that even in the hard sciences, neutral reasoning, to which logical empiricism had held, is a myth. Therefore, choosing creation as the starting point for our thinking about the relationship between God and the world is not taking a fideistic posture over against scientific rationality. Rather, it is a matter of consciously adopting one fiduciary framework among several competitors. Secondly, Alvin Plantinga has convincingly argued that Christian academics are within their epistemic rights to use a different basis for their reasoning than their non-Christian colleagues. As there are no neutral facts, why restrict ourselves to what is currently deemed to be academically correct? Instead, we may properly appeal in our account or explanation to anything else we already rationally believe, whether it be current science or Christian doctrine. So this is a quote from Alvin Plantinga. In particularly for those who believe that the Bible is divine revelation or that it includes reliable information about God's acts in history, it is legitimate to include the biblical teaching in the database from which they elaborate their view of the world. In fact, taking creation as the starting point is not only legitimate, but is required by theism itself. If we fully acknowledge God's transcendence, any general framework which subsumes God and the world is excluded. Such an overarching framework would constitute a reality over and above God, a perspective which cannot be accommodated by theism. Therefore, the distinction between the creator and his creation should not be confused with an antithesis between God and the world, as if God and world were notions at our disposal, of which we knew the definitions before interacting with the biblical data. If that was the case, it would make sense to inquire into their relationship and to try to elaborate a metaphysical system which could accommodate somehow both transcendence and immanence. But if God is the foundation of all being, we should not expect to be able to comprehend him, nor to master his relationship with the world by our own thinking. Instead, we should be prepared to learn from the biblical texts themselves who God is and how the world relates to him. We then come to see divine transcendence and immanence as non-antithetical considerations, but as two sides of the same coin. Divine transcendence and immanence can be explained, or not explained, but accounted for in creation. And this is taking a fiduciary framework very consciously. But any reasoning occurs inside a fiduciary framework. But that does not imply relativism, because the choice between frameworks is not arbitrary. Contending paradigms differ in the degree of warrant they enjoy. Coherence, ability to account for the data, and fruitfulness are three important criteria by which to judge their comparative value. This is not the place to attempt a wholesale justification of the biblical worldview. In what follows, I will concentrate on the implications of the biblical understanding of divine transcendence and immanence for the practice of science. In particular, I want to show that creation provides an illuminating framework in which to consider some of the questions which are raised by a scientific description of the world. In particular, the distinction between science and scientism, the question of reductionism, or in opposition to reductionism, a richly diverse world, scientific laws as partial causal contributions of our description of the world, and human freedom in a world described by science. So first, science without scientism. Creation provides a framework which is conducive to the scientific endeavor. But while science easily finds a place in the created world, divine transcendence guards against scientism, the illusion that science can explain everything. First of all, God, being transcendent, he is beyond scientific exploration. No humanly crafted theory will ever explain his nature or predict his action. But not only is God beyond scientific reasoning, the world, being his handiwork, also partakes of his incomprehensibility. This theme occurs frequently in Old Testament texts dealing with nature. It is prominent in the book of Job. The topic also comes up in the prophetic writings, particularly in Isaiah, Jeremiah. It does not foster globalist skepticism, as humanity is created in God's image and therefore shares his privilege of knowledge. But it highlights the fact that human knowledge is always partial. It's very interesting to see that historically, the conviction of nature's incomprehensibility underpinned Newton's empiricism. Humans cannot hope to attain an exhaustive rational knowledge and therefore need to perform experiments in order to see how God created the world. And human nature is always that of creatures, thus limited in scope. No scientist or philosopher or theologian can claim complete knowledge, which is the privilege of God alone. Therefore, science without scientism. Now turning to a second point, reductionism versus a richly diverse world. Humanity reflects something of the transcendence of the God whose image they bear. They are part of the created world, created on the sixth day together with the land animals, but at the same time, humans transcend the material world. Therefore, any methodology developed to describe non-human entities, which would include physics and chemistry, cannot provide a complete picture of human beings. In particular, the notion of personhood extends beyond the scope of the natural sciences objectifying method. One text would be 1 Corinthians 2, verses 10. And therefore, not even biology is inadequate for describing humanity. Thus, divine transcendence, reflected in humans as the image of God, prescribes scientific reductionism. Once we have acknowledged the difference between the human and the non-human, it becomes likely that there are more than just these two realms, but that the created world is composed of many facets. The first creation story in Genesis contains several clues that suggest plurality. The theme of separation is central in presenting creation. The separation between light and darkness, between day and night, between the water above and water below the firmament, between the sea and dry land. Moreover, plants and animals are created according to their kinds. The magisterial architecture of the account structures the work of creation in 6 days and thereby suggests a multifaceted reality. Non-reductionism has lately become fashionable in philosophy of mind, but also more generally in philosophy of science. But note that God's transcendence, as reflected in his human image, encourages a more radical departure from reductionism than standard emergentist models, in which higher levels supervene upon a typically physical base level. Instead, I would claim that methods of inquiry developed to describe the inanimate world do not enjoy any privileges over more personally involved interactions with reality, while trying to deduce the latter from the former. Instead, creation as the handiwork of the transcendent God leads to a clear acknowledgement of multiple dimensions. The contribution to our knowledge of each particular science, both natural and human sciences, is valuable but partial. Physics, biology, neuroscience, psychology, sociology, philosophy, theology, each adopts a specific angle of inquiry, a method which is befitting for certain questions but not for others. Like a spatial projection, each form of exploration captures one dimension of reality but does not provide a complete description. The perspectives just outlined bear some similarities to the conception which the philosopher Stephen Horst at Wesleyan University in Middletown, Connecticut, has developed under the name of cognitive pluralism. It is cognitive in the sense that it takes into account the constructive role of the mind in model building. Our models, in science or elsewhere, I quote, are idealized representations of particular features of the world. It is pluralist in the sense that it is inclined to take the plurality of existing models in the current sciences not as a transitory feature, but as a consequence of, I quote, facts about how the mind models the world. Believing otherwise would come down to the rationalistic assumption that everything about the world must be intelligible to us in the form of a single theoretical framework. Not only does this assumption seem quite hubristic, writes Stephen Horst, but also our best available scientific theories do not support it. General relativity and quantum mechanics are inconsistent with each other. Applied to scientific laws, cognitive pluralism takes them to be idealized description of the real world that highlight the dynamic principles that underlie real-world kinematics. This conception is both realistic, laws are invariants in the real world, and cognitivist, laws are part of our representation of the world. The second trait is the basis for there being multiple sets of laws or theories, because they are part of different representations depending on the invariance studied in a given context. Unless the rationalist assumption is true, our mind necessarily understands the world in a fragmentary way, so that the plurality of scientific models is irreducible. Therefore, we should not expect any one particular science, or even the sciences as a whole, to provide an exhaustive description of reality. On the contrary, dynamic laws express potential partial causal contributors to real-world kinematics. Such a pluralist view of scientific laws has immediate implications for reductionism. However successful a certain scientific model is in a certain domain, it does not preclude the possibility that there are other causal factors at work. Take as an example the law of gravitation. It does not say anything at all about the question of whether, in addition to gravitational forces, other causal factors are present which can be described by other laws, for example, electromagnetic forces. It does not even exclude the existence of extra causal factors which cannot be described by scientific laws, as would be the case for agent causation. Thus, it is simply wrong to consider that a scientific description of the world necessarily leads to reductionism or excludes free will. Thus, contemporary science, rightly understood, does not exclude free will. But up to now, we have only established that there are compatible, so contemporary science and human agency. But creation, with its particular understanding of the God-world relationship, provides a sure foundation for human freedom. Not only this, but it also allows us to understand the relationship between human freedom and the natural sciences, instead of positing them side by side as a more fragmented view of reality would do. Creation differs from other worldviews in that it places the origin of the world in the free act of the transcendent God. Creation does not stem from the nature of God, but from his will. The distinction between divine will and divine nature expresses the personal character of the biblical God. Only a personal God can will something into being that is different from his nature. I think I'm slightly out of rhythm with my presentation, so this is the right. Sorry for this. I was slightly in advance in the presentation. Okay. So creation differs from other worldviews in that the world is the result of God's will and not of his nature. And this expresses the personal character of the biblical God. Only a personal God can will something into being that is different from his nature. And the freedom of the creator is not a mere metaphysical presupposition. It pervades the whole of biblical religion. In this regard, we note the rejection of all forms of magic in the Bible. No rite is effective in itself. Divinity cannot be manipulated by magic formula or acts. Prayer must be an expression of trust from the heart and not a vain repetition of words. And Samuel reminds us that to obey is better than sacrifice. Human action finds its place in a world born by divine freedom. As the image of God, humanity participates in the power to act of their Creator and therefore in his freedom. Otherwise, they could not stand as a covenantal partner before God, nor fulfill their role as co-workers in the earthly creation. Gregory of Nyssa in the 4th century expresses it thus. He made human nature participant in all good. For if the deity is the fullness of good, and this is his image, then the image finds its resemblance to the archetype in being filled with all good. Thus there is in us the principle of all excellence, all virtue, and wisdom. But preeminent among all is the fact that we are free from necessity and not in bondage to any natural power, but have decision in our own power as we please. freedom of the Creator have as its corollary the freedom of humanity created in his image, creation also institutes a world order which is an appropriate environment for human action. One's conception of the origin of the world will inevitably influence one's conception of the order or absence of order in the world. Creation being a free act, providence as its twin doctrine bears the marks of free action. The world is neither governed by an impersonal law nor left to chance. In fact, though opposed, these two conceptions, either necessity or chance, have similar implications for human action. They place humanity in an impersonal environment. Human freedom would be an illusion, or at best, a desperate attempt at action in the face of an indifferent order. Personalist providence, instead, provides a context in which human action can make sense. It is only in a world created by the personal God of the Bible that human freedom is truly at home, as the neo-Calvinist apologist Cornelius van Til pointed out. A finite personality could function in none other than a completely personalistic atmosphere, and such an atmosphere can be supplied to him only if his existence depends entirely upon the exhaustive personality of God. The providence of the Creator God is neither fatum nor fortuna. On the one hand, it is transcendent and personal, so that it does not enclose created beings in an iron law inherent to the world that would prevent freedom. To use Calvin's words, we do not contrive a necessity out of the perpetual connection and intimately related series of causes which is contained in nature, but we make God the ruler and governor of all things. On the other hand, what happens is not random, and humans are not the products of pure chance, which will erase them as surely as it gave rise to them. Contrary to personalist providence, some revive Epicurean randomness by appealing to neo-Darwin evolution. But it should be noted first that such a metaphysical conclusion would only be warranted if neo-Darwinism delivered a complete picture of reality. Taking such a stance is scientism, which goes beyond science. Second, evolution does not amount to pure chance. Probabilistic evolutionary processes occur in the context of natural regularities described by laws. And third, Simon Conwell Morris, professor of evolutionary paleobiology at the University of Cambridge, has shown that neo-Darwinian evolution does not imply the absence of design in the universe. Convergent evolution is the fact that similar structures evolve through different evolutionary paths. And this fact argues that the emergence of intelligence resembling the human mind was inevitable. The similarity with certain aptitudes in higher animals, such as the great apes, dolphins, and even some birds, supports a Christian Platonist view of reality, implying universal rational principles, rendering an atheist interpretation of life very tenuous. Now moving to our last topic, human agency. In conclusion to our reflections on how creation accounts for human freedom, let us point out that this perspective has the advantage of offering a multidimensional but integrated view of humankind, providing space for their freedom without treating it as a foreign element or even as opposed to the scientific description. Admittedly, it is recognized that natural science cannot fully comprehend this freedom, any more than it can provide moral grounds for personal dignity or grasp the openness of humans to transcendence. The methodology used in physics, chemistry, or biology are not attuned to these aspects of human beings. But the integrated view provided by creation makes it possible to address the important question of the interactions between freedom on the one hand and scientific determinations on the other. Not only must nomad-kind approaches treat as illusory our experience that the will can have scientifically describable consequences. I decide of my own free will to raise my hand, and I manage to do so. Nor can more fragmented models account for the fact that we experience our freedom as non-absolute, but shaped by many physiological, environmental, social influences. Recent advances in neurosciences have highlighted in many ways the dependence of the higher cognitive faculties on genetic, physical, chemical, or social factors. But it is not a new discovery. Already Pascal meditated on the power of the fly that presents us from thinking. I quote Blaise Pascal, "The mind of the sovereign judge of the world, so the human being, is not so independent that it is not liable to be disturbed by the first din about it. Do not wonder if at present it does not reason well. A fly is buzzing in its ears." So that's a good excuse if you found my conference confused. I just need to find the fly buzzing in my ears. In fact, our actions are on a continuum between completely involuntary, unconscious actions like breathing, and deeply considered choices that engage our whole person. But such a continuum, which involves at various degrees our freedom as morally responsible agents and scientifically describable factors, cannot be understood in a model which has isolated human free actions from science, as does, for example, the Kantian distinction between phenomena and noumena, and more generally, any nomad-type approach. Instead, creation offers a more integrated perspective without conflating humans with their scientific description. Obviously, this does not save us the painstaking work of elaborating multidimensional models in order to capture selected aspects of human behavior and their interactions. Creation provides a productive theological starting point. It is not meant to be the end point in our exploration of the world. Rather, it sets a framework which opens up promising avenues for research. Thank you for your attention.
He is also the director for the program for Master in Science and Religion. I discovered that he, together with Steve Branwell, discovered the spin ice, a magnetic substance that does not have a single minimal energy state but has magnetic moments. It is spin, as elemental degrees of freedom which are subjects to frustrated interactions. He's still interested in physics, but focuses now on how scientists and biblical scholars interpret biblical and classical Christian texts. And of course, also he has written quite a lot. So one chapter, I will name two upcoming, is one chapter which is named "The Trees of the Field Shall Clap Their Hands." What does it mean to say that a tree praises God? Another one is from a contribution from the Science and Religious Forum, an editorial work which is called "Mental Well-being, Neuroscience and Religion," upcoming in Saigon. And then a last one I want to name is "When Jesus Lost His Soul: 4th Century Christology and Modern Neuroscience" in Scottish Journal of Theology, Volume 70, Number 1. Now I welcome Dr. Harry.
thanks also to the organisers for giving me this opportunity to respond to Lydia's paper, and of course thank you especially to Lydia for this very wide-ranging paper, which is steeped in biblical tradition, which is a very good thing in my opinion. I see Lydia as making three main, very valuable points. First of all, Lydia makes it abundantly clear that if we ever thought that divine transcendence and immanence were a paradoxical mystery, yet the biblical traditions find many fruitful ways of exploring this mystery. And Lydia made the point that there's no apparent tension between transcendence and immanence in the Bible, and we should use its texts as our starting point. Well, as a scientist myself, who sees his theological interests played out most fully now in biblical scholarship, I welcome her exhortation to get back to the Bible. And I think Lydia illustrates very well how these ancient texts can bring a clarity to our discussion that we so often overlook. Lydia's second move is to orient these texts around the theme of creation. It's only with respect to theological thought about creation, she points out, that transcendence and immanence make full sense. And she says this isn't a fideistic move, and she illustrates that by moving away from the texts to consider the theological roots of science. Lydia suggests that we can't make full sense of the scientific edifice without seeing it in light of creation. And given the historical roots of science, where the work of early modern scientists like Galileo, Descartes, and Newton was grounded in theological beliefs, I think that Lydia is absolutely right here, that it's not a fideistic move to see natural science as a whole in light of creation, although of course individual sciences work perfectly well without requiring such a theistic vision. And third, Lydia gives us quite a few of the building blocks for constructing a theology of science. A discussion of divine and human freedom versus determinism, of course, features strongly towards the end of her paper, but I actually want to highlight some of the detail that came before that, especially the way that she uses the image of God, the Imago Dei motif, to build a bridge to the philosophy of science. And she points out that recently in philosophy, there have been moves to abandon the previous generation's commitment to a monolithic naturalism and to acknowledge instead that it's enormously difficult to unify science from within, and perhaps we might be better off developing pluralistic conceptions of science instead. And Lydia suggests that the theology of creation helps here. Humans are made in the image of God, which means that we're privileged to share something of God's transcendent vision of the world. But nevertheless, we only see a partial vision. And Lydia compares this with the philosophical idea of cognitive pluralism, which explains the pluralism of science in terms of human cognition. We can't help but make multiple, but not quite consistent models and theories of the world, like relativity and quantum mechanics in physics, for instance. This multiplicity isn't necessarily a fact about the world in itself, and the theological notion of the Imago Dei explains why we might have such a privileged but partial insight into the world. Well, there's a lot of value here, a great deal of value, and I think that Lydia's thoughts certainly repay further reflection, not least because she mines the ancient wisdom of Jewish and Christian tradition. But I also have three questions that arise from these three main points. So first, as a biblical scholar, I'm perpetually anxious about the twin dangers of proof-texting and cherry-picking whenever the Bible appears. As you know, you can make the Bible mean anything you want to. So what are the hermeneutical criteria that Lydia uses to isolate her key texts? Well, as far as I can tell, Lydia often relies upon the spatial metaphor of distance and nearness of God from the world in order to isolate and identify biblical texts of transcendence and immanence. But what would happen if we looked at the host of other metaphors that the Bible uses to describe God? What if we looked at different modes of divine action and theophany in the Bible, analysing transcendence and immanence through narrative? What new texts might suddenly spring into focus concerning transcendence and immanence? What might we learn? Well, clearly there's something of a circle here, a hermeneutical circle. You get back something of what you put in. Second, speaking of divine action, creation may be our starting point for thinking through transcendence and immanence, but clearly it can't be the end point, at least not in the Christian vision. After all, a deist could affirm creation and would be led to make entirely different claims about transcendence and immanence. So what I want to ask is, what about divine action and what about redemption, and especially, what about Christ? Now, clearly our biblical traditions have a great deal to say here too, and the motifs of transcendence and immanence are still relevant. So I want to ask, what happens for our understandings of transcendence and immanence when we incorporate the economy of salvation alongside creation? The economy of salvation alongside creation. What kind of picture emerges then? And third, Lydia's use of cognitive pluralism, as seen through the Imago Dei, well, that tends to prioritise human cognition in the process of how we assess science theologically here. So science works with a plurality of models because although our vision of the world is privileged, it's also partial in this way of thinking. Our cognition is plural, and so is our science. But what I want to ask is, doesn't this lead us towards an anti-realist theology of science and nature? My own preference here would be for a resolutely realist view. For sure, knowledge of creation is limited, but that's because creation is contingent, which is why we need to study it empirically and painstakingly, but still with the hope that we can improve upon our knowledge of creation in itself. But if the limitations of science are actually hardwired pluralistically into our brains, can we ever hope to know creation better in scientific terms? Or are we just going round in circles against the plurality of our cognition? So, with those three questions, I want to say thank you, Lydia, again, for reminding us of the depths of the traditions we possess and for showing us how we can use them generatively.
On the hermeneutical criteria to isolate transcendence immanence in biblical texts. Obviously, there is the danger of proof texts or cherry-picking when dealing with the Bible. But I would still, as I hold to the Reformed doctrine of the clarity of Scripture, so I would disagree that you can prove everything from the Bible if you really accept to look to the whole Bible and that you accept to live in the biblical worldview. So it's an ongoing interaction, and this ongoing interaction is not just my person, but it's the whole tradition of the Christian faith. And therefore, obviously, what I've just chosen two or three texts here, and much more would be needed. But these texts sit, I would say, on the shared experience of Bible reading over the centuries. And these are strategic texts which come up whenever we look into the question of divine immanence. So it was part of how did I choose the text, part was my own memories. And then I must confess, I just took the systematics of several systematic theologies and said, what are the texts which come up when they talk about divine immanence? And then I checked the texts, and what I really found striking, and I hadn't expected it to this degree, that in the very same texts you would find divine transcendence stressed. So it's not some places you find divine immanence and some places you find divine transcendence, but you find them together, and as soon as the biblical author thinks about divine immanence, he thinks about divine transcendence and vice versa. Behind this kind of approach is obviously the idea that we have to develop our own thinking on the basis of explicit biblical teaching. There are other ways to do it, to do theology. One, I think, not a very good way to do it, is to do word studies. So James Farr has definitely showed us that this is the wrong way to come up with a biblical worldview, to study the words. So you need to privilege explicitly biblical teaching. So what about narratives? They're important, obviously. I would not want to oppose them to explicit biblical teaching. They are part of the teaching. So dogmatics or systematic, say theological elaboration, goes together with narrative and feeds on each other. And for example, the Psalm 139 is a prayer. It's not a dogmatic treatise, but it's part of the prayer, it's part of spirituality. You find divine immanence and transcendence. And it's not only about spatial metaphors, it's also about omniscience, it's about predestination, some kind of predestination. My days were written in your book. So it's a much wider interpretation of divine transcendence and of divine immanence. It's not just God is there, but God knows me, God is present to me, or I can't hide from his presence. So it's much richer than just a spatial metaphor. But then, if I say you should not oppose kind of more systematic theological elaboration to narratives, it's also because I think that we can't just elaborate our theology starting from salvation history events. So you find this kind of theology where you would take, for example, the cross and then deduce something about God's nature from the cross. I think even in order to know what was going on at the cross, you need the biblical interpretation of the event. So we can't isolate the events told of in the Bible from the biblical interpretation, which is delivered at the same time in the narratives and in the more systematic treaties of the New Testament in particular, but not only in prophetic writings in the Old Testament. So on redemption. Yes, redemption is important. I haven't dealt with it in this paper. You can only do so much in a paper. I'm currently working on a paper on personhood and Christology, and in particular to see what insights we can gain for our understanding human persons from the debates which led to the Confession of Faith of Chalcedon. So obviously, redemption is an important field to explore. But still, I go with the Reformed view of salvation history in this creation fall redemption. So redemption is, first of all, the restoration of creation. And if you say Reformed view, I think the Reformers were just sitting inside the great Christian tradition. You could go back to Thomas Aquinas, for example. So this is the way, I think, the Christian tradition thought about salvation history. But yeah, saying this certainly means that I'm not a Bartian on this. What are my arguments? Once again, I go back to the Bible. It's the very first verse of the Bible. The biblical worldview starts from creation. And Genesis 3 has as main, main teaching of this text. There are several important teachings. One of the important teachings of Genesis 3 is that sin is historical. It's not part of creation, it's not part of nature, but it's historical. I know that this is a difficult point for everybody interested in the science-theology dialogue, but I don't think that historical Christianity makes sense without holding to the idea that evil is not part of nature. And so therefore, there is a point in thinking about the world from creation, and then, only in the second step, to bring into evil, and then to bring into redemption. And the apostles, for example, when they preached to the pagan audience, they would always start from creation. They would never talk about redemption without speaking first about creation, because redemption doesn't make sense without creation. But having said that, I think there's a lot of interesting venues you can explore, and so redemption is important. I haven't dealt with this in this paper. Third, on Stephen Hawes. I must say that my encounter with Stephen Hawes is kind of paradoxical. In fact, I met Stephen Hawes' ideas first in a book edited by Nancy Cartwright and Keith Ward. And in my PhD on laws of nature and religious presuppositions, one of the authors I had worked on was Nancy Cartwright. I really enjoyed meeting her. She even invited me into her home to spend the weekend, so that was a treat for a PhD student. But I strongly resisted her view of the depth world in my PhD. And her view of the depth world is directly linked to her atheism. Yeah? Without God as a lawgiver, there are no universal laws of nature. And at the same time, I strongly resisted my PhD supervisor, who was a neo-Kantian. So we had regular discussions on realism and anti-realism, so that was quite interesting. So I had much stronger realist inclinations than he has. And so when I started to read Stephen Hawes, and especially even the very term of cognitive pluralism, I thought that I would disagree. And then it turned out to be the very opposite. In fact, I had, not that I changed my position, but he says it explicitly, that his position is a realist position. So I think the term is a kind of misnomer. In fact, when I read Stephen Hawes, it's one of the rare moments, I think, where you've come up with an intuition, so you feel that things must be like this, but I liked the precise way to pronounce it and to formulate it. And when I read Stephen Hawes, I thought, oh, this is in the end the rigorous philosophical explanation of what I wanted to say. And in fact, I had come up with the idea that different special sciences, including physics, provide selected aspects of reality, yeah, similar to spatial projections onto one dimension. So this was, as far as I had gone, so kind of metaphor in my mind. Special sciences are projections on certain dimensions of reality. But I struggled to came to a more rigorous formulation and argumentation for this. And then I met Stephen Hawes, so I read Stephen Hawes. And here I found a very precise formulation. So it's cognitive pluralism, but it's realist, because the scientific laws select real aspects of the world. So it's not only our models, it's not only our projections on the world, but they select real world invariants. So I think there you can get both. You can get the pluralist, cognitivist approach, but it's realist. It's not just our mind projecting its own structure on the world. So Stephen Hawes sounds like Nancy Cartwright in many respects, but he's not Nancy Cartwright. And his position is realist, and this is why I'm happy with it.